To make it swing.
Huh?
It's a football.
Yeah, I know it, I know it.
That's not a big issue with me.
No, I was just wondering.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, we heard from Cisneros.
Came out okay.
Senator Kerry.
Glad you heard from Cisneros as long as he's while he's there.
I want to know the way he prepared.
I heard Cisneros was here.
For 2-4.
We'll call the meeting to order. Meeting of 12/94/95, March 15th, 1995, 7:30. And will the clerk call the roll, please?
Chairman Jordan?
Yeah.
Counselor Chapel?
Here.
Counselor Cogswell?
Here.
Counselor Dahlbeck?
Yep.
Counselor Linnell?
Here.
Counselor Marvin?
Here.
And Counselor McLaughlin? Here.
Thank you. Will you all please rise and we'll salute the flag?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We have, next on the agenda, we have people here to receive a award from the Maine Waste Management Agency, and they would like to, I don't know, I didn't get here in time enough to get introduced, but I take it you're the spokeslady.
I'm Mandy Garmey, and I want to introduce the presenters tonight. On behalf of the Recycling Committee, I want to welcome, and I'm very happy to have John Williams, who's the new director of the Maine Waste Management Agency, and Gail Briggs, who is also with Maine Waste Management, and she is the Waste Cap Coordinator. They're here tonight to make a presentation to our town employees, recognizing the hard work that they've done to promote recycling efforts in our town offices. I want to thank the Maine Waste Management Agency for all the technical support that they've given us over the years. Through their assistance and other things, we have, to date, achieved $65,000 avoided costs, meaning that that $65,000 worth of transportation and incineration fees we've avoided by recycling goods here in town. I also want to thank Mike McGovern. He has been very committed to our program, and he has provided us the direction that we needed to continue the efforts of the committee. So with this, I'd like to turn it over now to John Williams and Gail.
Thank you for having me be here tonight. I'm recently back in Maine, from Maine, but I'd spent a year and a half in New York, and because I couldn't get a job here. And I just started this job again, and it's really nice to be back in Maine communities. I'm here to present some awards tonight, and I'd like to first just explain what this is for. The Cape Elizabeth is now a Maine model community. And this is a program that was developed by the Maine Waste Management Agency to assist businesses, civic groups, municipal offices, and homeowners with reducing and recycling their waste. The program recognizes and uses as role models businesses, schools, municipal offices, and civic groups because they generate less waste that needs to go into our solid waste facilities. By becoming you can become a role model or a model community by meeting pre-established criteria such as using reusable products, reducing the use of office paper, purchasing supplies in bulk, setting up in-house recycling programs for office paper and corrugated cardboard. There are other ways you can do this whole number of criteria. Cape Elizabeth will become the ninth community to be a model community for recycling. And it's very likely that you'll be the last, at least the last that the Maine Waste Management Agency will be promoting because, as you may know, Governor King is supporting the dismantlement of the agency that I'm now working for, and the legislature does not appear to be inclined to go against that. So I'm not sure that the program, at least through the Maine Waste Management Agency, will be around much longer, although it may, I hope, will continue under another state agency. Speak a little bit about Cape Elizabeth and the model community status here. Cape Elizabeth, the recycling committee decided that before businesses in town could be approached, the town needed to establish credibility with their own recycling programs within the town buildings, schools, and municipal buildings. Your town manager, Mike McGovern, appointed recycling coordinators for each of the municipal offices, that is the library, public safety, town hall, public works, and the schools. And the coordinators work to develop recycling programs. Just some examples of what's been done in town. All municipal staff have been given reusable beverage mugs instead of using paper or styrofoam. The library uses cloth towels instead of disposable paper towels. The office supplies are purchased with recycled content when they can be, and also less paper is used by doing things like copying double-sided. Something we do here, these are my notes on this side and on the back. I don't know what it is, but it's a page that we didn't need anymore. And that type of thing is being done here in Cape Elizabeth as well. Now, some of the records which used to be stored on paper are now stored on computer disks. And as Mandy pointed out, and I didn't know, you've had $65,000 in avoided costs by doing this. So it helps us by reducing the need for landfill space and helps you in reducing your costs. Well, I'm here tonight to give awards to your recycling coordinators who've done just an outstanding job. Of course, I haven't been involved in this program that long, but Gail has, and she's told me what a wonderful job the people here in Cape Elizabeth have done. We recognize that this was a community-wide effort, particularly amongst the town employees, but tonight we're going to give special recognition to the coordinators. Jane Beckworth from the library. I'm supposed to say that Jane has been quietly recycling for years. I don't know if that means you've been quiet about it, Jane, or you've been recycling for years, or both.
Both.
Okay. Bob Lehman from Public Safety, who has been responsible for sorting and collection systems. George Manilakis from the Town Hall. George. Thanks. George, I am told that you personally made the corrugated recycling program work here in town. Next, the award, at least the name on here, is for Bob Malley, Robert Malley. I believe he's not here tonight, and Ken Meserve is, from Public Works, who and I guess Public Works has been instrumental in initiating the recycling programs townwide here. Thanks. Now, I have two more awards, and I believe they're not here. Louise Strout from the school department. Louise is apparently not here. Okay. And Carlene Osborne from the town hall. Now, Mandy, would you like me to leave these with you? Okay. Hey, well, thank you again for having me be here. Before I go, I'd like to acknowledge the town-appointed recycling committee members, certainly Mandy Garmy, the chair. Carol Fritz, I don't know if you're here or not. Carol Fritz, Martha Palmer, Scott Collins, Lynn Jones, Joanne Daigle, and Jean Fine. Thank you all, and thanks for helping us.
Just want to make sure that all the recipients and our guests come back for my lemon bars and cider.
Thank you. I think you've all done a tremendous job in the recycling part that's been going on in Cape Elizabeth, and I commend you all. I think it's been a long, hard row, and I wouldn't have been surprised if you've given up somewhere along the line, but some of you have stuck with it, and I think it's tremendous. Anybody else on the council got a comment in that direction?
Mr. Chairman, I'd suggest that the recycling committee stick around. I've got some remarks during my report tonight you might like to hear.
We won't let him go on.
Take 5 minutes. Within 5 minutes.
We won't let him go on too long. Yes.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I just wanted to again commend the recycling committee and say that it's good to have John Williams back in Maine.
We don't know how long, so he'll be happy. Anybody else? Reports and correspondence.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
I'll get this out of the way so that they can all go home. The National League of Cities Conference was held the last 5 days in Washington, D.C., and I had the privilege of going and representing Cape Elizabeth, and it was extremely important to me because there were so many people there that we could see in such a short period of time and talk about issues. And, of course, I only had one issue at my in front of me all the time, and that was flow control. We were lucky enough to hear from Henry Cisneros, the U.S. Secretary of Department of Housing and Urban Development. We had Senator Kerry and Senator Gregg on entitlements. We had the House Speaker, Newt Gingrich. I loved him. I thought he was great. We had, we had President Clinton. I've always loved him and thought he was great. I've never voted for him. It was just a wonderful period. And then we finished it off with something that I've looked forward to since I've been on the council, and that is 1 hour with each one of our representatives in their office. Now, let me tell you, this is nice. It costs a little money, but it is well worth it because you can sit there right across from all four for that 1 hour and express the things that you think are bothering you in town. I started out each one of the meetings with flow control. And for those here that do not know what flow control is, or those at home, that's the authority or the power for a community to be able to regulate its own waste. We at Cape Elizabeth do not have too much trouble because most of ours is residential and we know where it goes. But a lot of them, there's a lot of commercial stuff that is not going to RWS. When it was first formed and the money was put up in the tune of about $100 million, why, the idea was that we would take all waste over there to be burned. And that kept our rates down, our tipping fees down. The minute that the Supreme Court tossed that out as being unconstitutional, that we couldn't control this because of interstate commerce rules, we lost that control. And it's been quite a job the past year to keep it down. And we were looking at possibility of $124 a ton tipping fees next year against $68 that you're paying now. Quite a difference. Quite a different. Well, here's the nice part about the whole thing. We sat Monday afternoon in Badaki's office, a representative. He was fine to us. We went out of there feeling good. We moved on to Longley's office. He was fine, and we left there feeling good. We got to Senator Snow. And Senator Snow, I started out with Senator how nice it was to be there, and I was so glad that she had run for U.S. Senate, because then I could vote for her. With all my heart. When she was representative just of the Northern District, I couldn't. And she looked at me and said, what do you want? And so I gave my flow control spiel to her, and she says, I don't see how you can operate without flow control of one type or another, and it's one of my priorities. We felt good. We got to Senator Cohen's office. I hardly got a chance to start on my flow control spiel to him when he says, I've got something I want to tell you. And he said, just yesterday, I talked with the chairman of the committee that brings these items to the floor, and he's assured me that within a week, sometime next week, this will be on the floor of the House, and grandfathering of the towns that had flow control are in that bill, and I support it 100%. I said, I can go home very happy. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else have a report? Yes, Councilor Linnell.
Yes, I'd just like to make a few brief remarks. I was also down in Washington on the trip to the National League of Cities. I would just like to touch on a couple of highlights. I felt fortunate to have an opportunity to meet the leader of the free world, President Clinton. And in fact, as the manager and Councilor Chappell also did, and I recorded it, we recorded it that moment. And I don't know if you can see this at home, but I'm very pleased to have met a president. Also, as we'll discuss later, we were very privileged to have the opportunity to meet the chairman of the FCC, Reed Hunt. And I know if John Serban is watching at home, that he'll be pleased to know that we've made some progress there. We have some ideas on where to go from here on the cable issue. And finally, probably the highlight of the trip for me was after a day of meetings, the town manager and I took a walk down by the White House, and we were approached by a couple who asked us a few questions about the White House. And you think you know someone. Well, I didn't know this side of Mike McGovern, but apparently it's secret agent McGovern, because the people thanked us, and they, after our manager gave them quite a lot of information about the White House and how the offices go, and they were very appreciative to have this kind of contact with the Secret Service agent. Thank you.
That takes care of it?
Yes, sir.
Anybody else? Got a report, correspondent? Yes, Councilor McLaughlin.
These gentlemen are such hard acts to follow. On February 15th, I attended the monthly meeting of the Greater Portland Council of Governments Executive Committee. We had a brief information on the GIS mapping that COG is able to do now, and I'll pass through to the council if I want it back, because it's the only one I got, a copy of a sample GIS colored map of Cape Elizabeth, the colors depicting our shoreland zoning, just for your information, folks. We also had a presentation by a CPA firm about how to read financial reports, which is, you always pick something up from those folks, and it happened to be the firm that does our work for us, too, so that was interesting as well, but different people than we see doing our presentations. It was an informational presentation about the potential of a county charter commission. I don't know if that will go anywhere or not, but just let you know that that's being discussed at that level anyway. And over the weekend, I too was involved with National League of Cities. I was down in Washington for a work weekend, unlike the others on the council who attended. I'm on the Leadership Training Council of National League of Cities. I believe I'm one of just two representatives from New England, the other being a fellow from Cambridge, Massachusetts. This is the body that sets the policy about the National League of Cities training programs and its seminars, and it's a fine group of people to work with, and I'm able to do that because I am a counselor here, although my trip did not cost this town any money this time, and I just thank people for letting me do those things.
Thank you. Anybody else? No?
Michael.
Oh.
I just had a couple of quick items. I'll go down here to do it. Sometimes things need to be clarified, and I want to use the opportunity this evening to clarify a couple of things that have been in the newspaper about a number of issues. First is there seems to be a lot of confusion in town as to where the town and school budget stands, and there's been a lot of numbers thrown around. And what I want to do is briefly outline, very briefly, exactly what the staff, i.e. the superintendent of schools and I, will be proposing to the school board and to the town council. I'm not going to advocate for any numbers. I'm simply going to indicate what is being recommended so it may reduce some confusion. Looking at it on a two-year basis, what was done last year and what was done this year. Currently, what we're looking at is 0% increase both last year and this year on the town budget. On the school budget itself, the operating, boy, that looks pretty bad. again, is both zero and zero. 0% last year, 0% this year. On the school bond, it's 7% last year, and it was indicated that it was going to be 5% this year back when the school bond was originally voted on. What is being recommended is 3.5%. The county, the Cumberland County, is, I forget exactly what it was this year, but for this year, it's going to add up to 1.5%. So as the recommended budgets now stand, coming from the superintendent to the school board, and from the town manager will be coming to the town council next year, there's a recommended tax increase, again, before any review, of almost exactly 5%, which is 90 cents on the tax rate, or from 1770 to 1890. And in the coming weeks, through the leadership of Councilor Dalbeck as chairman of the Finance Committee and the continued work of the school board in reviewing budgets, all of these numbers will be looked at and reviewed. But this is really the starting point as to what is being recommended. And, you know, who knows between now and when there's a public hearing on the budget the second Monday in May and what happened. But those are the numbers and where it stands at this point. Second, I did want to clarify something that I was very surprised to read in the newspaper on Saturday. There was an article in relating to a public hearing I had attended in the city of Augusta about a week and a half ago. And this particular article, and there was a meeting on the county budget process, and the town council had taken a position against a certain bill that would reform the county budget process. Well, ultimately, the bill was revised somewhat, and I think in a much more pleasing manner. So at legislative hearings, they have an opportunity to speak either for a bill, against a bill, or either at the end to give information on a bill. So since the council hadn't taken a formal position on the revised bill, I took the position of speaking at the latter portion of the meeting on neither for nor against, and indicated and said to the legislature, to the committee, which was chaired by Senator Jane Amaro, who lives here in Cape Elizabeth, is a past chairman, and mentioned that when she was council chairman, where Bill Jordan now sits, not too many years ago, about 10, we paid a county tax of $150,000. And now the county tax is $550,000. And then I made the comment, because things were a little tense and trying to be a little light, that nothing had risen faster in Cape Elizabeth other than the county tax and the stature of Senator Jane Amaro. And she blushed, and everyone laughed. And the next Saturday in the newspaper, there was a headline that says, "Cape manager has sharp words for legislator." And I know Jane and others got some calls wondering why the town manager of Cape Elizabeth is picking on Jane Amaro. But let me read from, I was about to write to the newspaper and protest, but Barbara Ray, my secretary, gave me a copy of a thesaurus. And I looked up sharp, and it indicates clever, wise, witty, quick. And I assume the newspaper was using those meanings of sharp rather than the ones that first come to mind. So I do want to publicly indicate that I have tremendous respect for Senator Amaro, and any headline that may have been misinterpreted is unfortunate, and she, as everyone knows, does a lot for Cape Elizabeth, and I appreciate what she does too.
I can report from Thank a conversation you. With Jane that she took your remark as you intended it.
Thank you.
And I had talked to Senator Amaro this sometime afterwards, and she says, "I know Michael and his comments."
She knows Michael very well.
And it bothered other people more than it did her. Anybody else? So we'll move on to the minutes of the meeting of 10-94-95, held February 13th, 1995. Anybody got any comments, one way or the other? Do I hear a motion to accept them?
So moved.
Been moved and seconded to accept the minutes of the meeting of February 13th, 1995 as printed. All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote. Minutes of 11-94-95 were scheduled for February 27th, 1995. It was not held due to the inclement weather The agenda continues the item and members and numbers from the February 13, 1995 meeting. The next item is citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Anybody got anything they'd like to say that isn't on the agenda? If not, we'll move on to a public hearing on accessory dwelling units. And I'll turn it over to Ordinance Committee Chair Lady, Council Cogacilla.
Chairman is fine.
Well, I didn't want to have one of you get after me because they did one.
No, Chairman, really, it's not a gender-oriented term, if you check the derivation of the word. This is the public hearing. The reason this has been brought forward is for a number of years, there has been some difficulty in trying to define exactly what was considered to be the measurable living space in a house that if someone applied for an accessory dwelling unit. So we have actually defined it clearly and how it's to be measured and tied it in with the rest of the ordinances. That's under section 19.1.3 in definitions, under section 19.4.7 under the jurisdiction of the zoning board. We have told what the intent is for this to be created and the different qualifications. We did not at any time change the items that are referred to as part of the consideration, the items that have stood the test of court trial and appeal, because those are substantially the way we wanted them to be, and the zoning board did not have any difficulty with those at all. But this, what it basically does now is that it allows this kind of a unit to be constructed in new construction, where before it was only in an already constructed house. The size of the apartment is reduced from 900 square feet to 300, up to 600 square feet, which better emphasizes the real intent of this is to allow some small separate living space. It does not mean to create a large living unit or a duplex, as is often misquoted in the newspaper. The house size has been reduced from 2,500 square feet to 1,500 square feet. One of the criteria that we wanted to have was that it be owner-occupied. This also emphasizes the intent that it's not meant to be a real rental unit and that the house itself is not supposed to be a rental unit. This is a qualification that is in Nantucket and some of the other areas whose ordinances we studied, but our attorney sort of recommends that we don't do it. He feels part of the reason is that it's difficult to enforce. And one of the other criteria now is that no variances be granted.
That's all?
That's basically it, other than what I read through last week.
Thank you. Is anybody from the audience would like to speak? I'll open the public hearing. Anybody out have a few words they'd like to say? Step up the podium and give your name, please.
My name is Michael Bowdler. I live on Trundy Road. I don't care too much for public speaking, so forgive me if I read it out. The town deliberations on the accessory apartments, in an effort to inhibit the growth of tenement-type environment, it has cited lot size as being countable criteria. The planning board, I understand after much work, settled on a lot size of 12,000 square feet and recommended this. I understand that the ordinance committee upped this area to 15,000. My personal interest is that I would like to add a kitchen for an in-law, but I'm precluded from applying because I only have 13,400. I submit to the town that the lot size has absolutely no bearing whatsoever on the merits for an additional kitchen. Inclusion of lot size in consideration is purely arbitrary. I can understand the frustration for officials charged with keeping standards and the psychology of thinking we have to start somewhere. We should start somewhere, but not anywhere. In taking the lot size, the town is grasping for straws. I feel that the town should be aiming at far more important criteria, such as the appearance of the building, and if possible, the total volume of the total occupancy of a building. It's ironic that the typical applicant for an extra kitchen will be the single person wishing to add just one more to their property's occupancy, while next door there may be numerous people in one household. To add a kitchen within the existing profile geometrically will lessen the potential volume for living space and therefore cut the occupancy. It's also ironic that in attempting to keep property values from lowering, the town is actually fostering the increase of property values by allowing an additional kitchen. Because once the real estate catch on to the fact that some properties can put an extra kitchen in, that will inflate the value of that property and probably inflate the value of property in Cape Elizabeth, which is ironic considering the general clamour that it's going to lower value property values. The addition of a kitchen, to me, is no more of a calamity than the addition of bathroom several decades ago. The addition of bathroom was a growth into a more sophisticated way of life. The addition of kitchens could be considered and contemplated in the same light. The rule that those with less than a certain number of square feet are precluded from applying is downright discrimination. The sketch I've done is roughly to scale the block of property where I live, sandwiched between Trundy Road and Weyburn. All the lots to the right-hand portion of the diagram would come under the 15,000 square feet allowance. The four lots you see at the left-hand end would be victimized because they happen to have been created by whoever laid out the lots years and years ago. They're sandwiched in a corner which is bound to make a lot size smaller geometrically. Those five lots are precluded with absolutely no reason. Someone on one of these lots may want to add a kitchen, while someone on these lots may not. What possible justification is there for preventing someone on the far left-hand lot from building an additional kitchen? It's immoral. A while back I wrote the town a letter. I spent a long time writing a letter to put as much in as less space as possible. In it I suggested what I think is a more constructive way of tackling the problem. I'm just as personally interested in everyone else's keeping value of properties high and not drifting into a tenement environment. What I suggested was the town adopt legislation to create a contract with an applicant for, say, a three-year period. That contract could be renewed entirely at the option of the town. This would keep 100% control on the standards and the environment around that property. That makes far more sense than arbitrarily using the lot size. I think there's a moral issue here. There's many people that are not at this meeting, many people in town, that may in the future want to apply for a kitchen and don't know what's going on here because they're not public-minded, but their interests should not be ignored. I hope the town's attention to this, to my comments, won't be in proportion to the briefness that I'll try to keep my speech. Thank you.
Thank you. See anybody else? Nope. No one else? Oh, yes. Oh, now we got them coming. Now they're coming up. Yes, sir.
Good evening. My name's Coleman Gorham, 17 Bowery Beach Road. 5 years ago, I applied for an accessory apartment permit. It was denied on the basis that it would adversely affect adjacent property. This apartment was for my disabled sister, and she's now in a nursing home for 5 years. I do not intend or plan to apply in the future. However, I am still interested in the matter. Before I proceed, I would like to commend the planning board and also the zoning ordinance for their work on the ordinance that probably will be discussed tonight, the revisions. I found that the revisions, you know, appear to be quite liberal, and again, I commend you for that. But also, I think we have to keep in mind also that it's not just the accessory revisions on the accessory apartment, but also we have to look at the conditional use, because standard 4 is a very critical standard. And unless that's properly addressed, then I think this problem is going to continue forever. Also, I feel strongly that the Planning Board and also the Ordinance Committee made a mistake in not addressing this particular adverse effect standard in the conditional use. They did very well on the others, but they, I think they should have addressed it.
That's the way it was.
Also, when I talked to the chairman of the planning board and asked him why he, or the board didn't address that, his comment was that he thought that the zoning board should be given more discretion in their decisions. But I feel that this can be dangerous and can lead to arbitrary decisions. And that a very important basic principle of government is at issue here, in that a legislative body, which the town council is, cannot delegate to a board the powers that they have, and this is what has been happening. Also, from my experience, I am convinced that the zoning board did not and does not know the intent of the town council in regard to accessory apartments. And also, what is equally disturbing is that the zoning board made no effort to go back to the town council to try to get an interpretation as to what their intent was when they drafted the ordinance. What I have learned from the 1987 hearing is that the planning board members openly confessed to the fact that they didn't understand the town council's intent when they framed standard 4 of the conditional use ordinance. At the public hearing in October of 1989, at least 3 zoning board members are on record as saying that they didn't know what the town council's intent was in regard to the adverse effect standard. For example, the chairman stated, where did they intend that we should allow multi-unit dwellings? Was it intended to be restricted to a particular area? Because I don't see it in the provisions, or were they telling us that this is not a variance that's required by the conditional use, and we shall allow it in every area of town, whether it's next to my house or your house, that they're telling us that we have to allow it, that it's not up to us to decide whether it's a good idea or not. The direction of the town has been always single-family dwellings, and this is important, and maybe the council made a mistake in allowing multi-unit dwellings. It says it shouldn't have allowed any in this town. Later, the chairman stated, quote, if I were drafting the ordinance, I wouldn't want to see a lot of multi-unit dwellings. And I'm having real problems figuring out why, if the conditions are met, we shouldn't allow it. And in answer to the chairman's question as to where in Cape Elizabeth could a conversion be approved, a board member responded as follows. He said that there are two situations that I found. Number one is where you add vacant land, and if you have vacant land, you can put in and it wouldn't adverse effect. And secondly, you could have a number of dilapidated houses, for example, in which if you put in a nice house in, it would not adversely affect. And the chairman responded by saying, quote, I think we have to put ourselves in the position of the council in 1987 when they drafted the ordinance, not in 1925. We have to try to think what they intended, and there weren't a lot of dilapidated neighborhoods in 1987 in the town that might have intended to be converted to multi-dwellings. And later, a board member added a third instance where an accessory unit could be approved. And he said that approval could be granted if the conversion was in a business zone. Okay, and the chairman expressed the board's confusion when he said, quote, there probably isn't any other place in this town except this area that we're in right now, 17 Bowery Beach Road, where there is as much multi-use property as there is in this general area that's the subject of this application. And if it's not permitted in the area we're talking about tonight, then it probably isn't permitted, shouldn't be permitted anywhere else in town. And yet, we're faced with an ordinance that says we're supposed to permit it if certain conditions are met. The chairman and the other four members voted to deny the application. Although the zoning board knew that the intent of the council was to approve if the conditions were met, the zoning board decided that the ordinance was wrong and denied the application.
Sir, do you have much more?
No, I do. I just have a couple.
Just a couple of things?
Yes.
Okay, I'm sorry I didn't say at the start of it that each one had 5 minutes, but you can go ahead.
And it was the zoning board's position that whenever you place an accessory dwelling next to a single family house, it would automatically adversely affect the value of the single family house. And with this mindset, it is obvious that the council's intent to allow accessory apartments would not or will not be carried out. Okay, so clear up the confusion surrounding the adverse effect standard of the conditional use ordinance, I respectfully ask the council to accept an amendment submitted by John Bannon, which is contained in a letter that he sent to you, or which I had sent to you. And the essence of the amendment has to do with, there has to be something unique about a particular application that would cause the zoning board to deny the application. So thank you for listening.
Thank you. This gentleman over here, you still want to speak?
Yes.
Go ahead.
I was born in
Your name, please?
Yes, sure. Thurston Holt. I was born in Cape Elizabeth at a shoreside house. And I grew up in Staten Island, but I summered here. And the house was in the family until 1979, when my mother died, and the four children at that time had moved away. I came back to Portland 3.5 years ago to live, and I'm single, and my family are scattered. So I live in a Cape Elizabeth apartment. But Coleman Gorman called me up, and I'm president of the Cape Elizabeth South Portland Seniors, and he wondered if he could speak 5 minutes to our group in favor of accessory housing. And I said, fine. And on the basis of that, I wrote a letter to Tom Emery on the planning board saying that I thought that it would be important to have a reasonably generous accessory apartment ordinance, particularly for an older member of a family, say the younger people in the family own the house, but the older relative is getting a little feeble and yet wants to be independent as long as possible. And by building the apartment and giving some independence to the relative, that will postpone, among other things, the day when the relative has to go to a nursing home, may eliminate it entirely. And I think we all know that when you go to a nursing home, your savings get melted down pretty fast, for the most part, and then you go on Medicaid. So I believe that a reasonable accessory apartment ordinance for Cape Elizabeth would cut down on health care costs by allowing older but getting feeble relatives to live independently as long as possible, and the family would be close by in case they needed help. And I would just request that the ordinance be worded so that it was pretty definite, and that a homeowner next door to a proposed accessory apartment would not be able to just zap the thing by saying, oh, well, it's going to cut down on property values. I think that's about it. Also, I think that sometimes if a family has an extra apartment, it can work out if, say, they're middle-aged, that they can give a young couple starting out in business a housing opportunity to get going. Thank you very much.
Yes, just a minute. I didn't get your address.
60 Woodland Road.
60 Woodland.
Yeah, Fairfield 8, because there are a couple of buildings with F, so
okay.
In Cape Elizabeth.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
Yes, sir. Gentleman in the back. Oh.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the council. My name is Robert Goldman, and I live at 27 Bowery Beach Road in Cape Elizabeth. I've been involved in this process for over 5 years. I've been a companion of Mr. Gorham's in this effort. I would like to say that I, too, appreciate the efforts of the council. I think we have an extraordinarily dedicated public servant selected and volunteer, and I appreciate the graciousness that was shown me at the Ordinance Committee and the openness. Other people would be here today. Greg Powell would be here today. Glenn Robinson would be here today, but they're out of state on business. Some of them may have submitted letters, I'm not sure. I think my presentation might have more than 5 minutes involved in it. I'm going to try to get through some of it quite quickly. Mr. Gorham has continuously, for the past 5 years and repeatedly, reviewed the testimony at the Zoning Board of Appeals, in which he had three hearings, and selectively picks out pieces of that testimony for the point he tries to make. What the court said on two occasions, the Superior Court and Supreme Court, is that the Zoning Board of Appeals members were very deliberate. They reviewed the testimony very carefully and discussed it at length. And to select out something when they were trying to be probative and examine the issues and so on, be the devil's advocate on occasion, is simply unfair and it should stop. What I will do, rather than cover his latest letter, is refer to what the Supreme Judicial Court said about this. And this refers to Mr. Bannon's letter, which also reviewed some of the old testimony and the old chestnuts that have been thrown out. The Supreme Court said, the statements of the board members themselves, contrary to Gorham, this is a quote, contrary to Gorham's contention, do not reflect an unlawful bias or predisposition. Rather, the entire record indicates the board members listened attentively, questioned witnesses, both for and against the petition, and discussed the evidence with a view toward making a sincere effort to fairly decide the issue before making a decision. The board conducted three hearings, received and considered a number of documents, including reports of appraisers, and heard comments from a number of residents. The evidence is inadequate to support Mr. Gorham's contention that he was denied due process due to bias and predisposition. With respect to the issue of conditional use and the impact on property values, the court said, contrary to Gorham's first contention, the maintenance of property values is a legitimate interest served by zoning restrictions. Therefore, the Cape Elizabeth Zoning Ordinance meets the due process requirement that it bears a reasonable relationship to public health, safety, morals, and general welfare. The court then went on to discuss in general terms the acceptance of the notion of conditional use. I think that Michael Hill was correct when he said if you do away with these conditional use standards, then it's pretty much up for grabs when applications are made and the town loses control. And I think that that's important. Let me move on to the origin of the initiative to review a change of the in the ordinance. From recent workshops and planning board discussions, we now understand that the proposed change is intended neither to meet the affordable housing interests or be limited to in-laws or relatives in need. Nonetheless, constant reference has been made both to affordable housing and taking care of in-laws. Let me just go to what I think was the origin or the lever that raised this issue and brought it forward again. Originally, reference was made to the comprehensive plan and to the affordable housing report. I looked at them again today, and what I noted was in the comprehensive plan and the affordable housing report, they are one lines which are devoted to the issue of accessory apartments. All the remainder of the reports are devoted to the real issue of affordable housing, and that is development of housing that people can buy of low income and moderate means. And we have an affordable housing ordinance in town. I think it's important to know that only one small aspect of this has been mentioned in terms of accessory apartments. But let me mention what the comprehensive plan says about accessory apartments. It says that the town should reconsider provisions for accessory apartments in owner-occupied dwellings. That's what the comprehensive plan says. In the affordable housing report, it says that the town might revise the zoning ordinance to increase a homeowner's ability to create an accessory accessory apartment unit. It refers to a homeowner, it doesn't say property owner. Now, if the genesis of this is in the comprehensive report, an affordable housing report, it seems to me that the language in those two reports would be important. And both of them refer to owner occupancy, a homeowner occupancy, and I think that that's the intent of them.
Do you have much more? Excuse me.
Not too much more, but I think it's important.
I'll give you another minute or two, okay?
I'm going to do it in a minute, but I'll try
okay.
to do as much as I can. All the publicity and activity regarding has been around the issue of in-law apartment. I think it's important, and Mr. McVeigh raised this in his original letter, that the residents of the town have supported in-law use for a long time. We did that when Mr. Gorham started his business back in 1988. He came around with petitions saying he only wanted it at that time for an elderly aunt. Then when he sat at my table and discussed it, I said, well, what happens when the elderly aunt goes? He said, well, we do have a sister that may need it. And I said, well, what happens after that? He said, I have no intention ever of using it for rental accommodations. We learned differently when he came before the zoning board. What I'm saying to you is that I think we can craft an ordinance that deals with in-laws and permits in-laws to come in and do it wisely and well, and I think that's what we should do. We can take care of in-laws. The more I think about this issue, the more I think it opens it up, makes an entitlement out of putting in a small apartment for use of anybody, and I think that's a poor practice for the town of Cape Elizabeth to pursue. I hope I met the minute. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes.
My name is Bill Dubler, and I live at 989 Shore Road. And I have one question to ask the Madam Chairman on the zoning board. If you already have an existing house and you want to keep your mother there, and it's a two-story house, can you revert that into a mother and daughter apartment? Is that covered under this zoning law? I didn't see or wasn't clarified on that.
I'm not sure exactly what you're asking.
You got a two-story house. You live in the bottom half, and you want to turn the top half in and add a kitchen for your mother to live in.
If it meets the requirements in the ordinance.
Yeah, but I didn't see it. Could I come in and find that out in detail?
The thing to do would be to come in and talk to the code enforcement officer, Mr. McVeigh.
Yes, ma'am.
He would go over your situation with you and tell you directly.
But this 1,500 square feet wouldn't affect that, right?
The 1,500 square feet of the actual living space?
Yes, ma'am.
You would have to have that, yes. Before you could even qualify. If you have more than that, then you can still qualify.
Fine.
Okay.
That's the bottom threshold.
Okay. So if I meet all the other qualifications, then I shouldn't have too much trouble, hopefully.
Well, not knowing exactly what your situation is, I'm not going to make a comment one way or the other, but I think Mr. McVeigh is the one who will answer your questions.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, town councilors. Tom Emery, I live at 12 Juniper Lane. I'm representing as chairman of the planning board. I'm speaking this evening. I just want to reinforce the issue of lot size. The planning board discussed and debated that issue at length. We looked at diagrams from 10,000 square feet up to 40,000 square feet and discussed at some length the issue that there was no particular zoning in town that dealt with a 15,000 square foot lot. So we wondered out loud and indicated through our draft ordinance that perhaps 12,000 was a lot size that would not have any unreasonable impact that a 15,000 lot size might not would also have. We felt that perhaps a 10,000 square foot lot was getting a little small and there could be perceivable impacts because of additional traffic, although geometrically there didn't seem to be much. It seems that since our town is divided into two residential districts, that perhaps it is appropriate to think of accessory dwelling units in that same way, that if indeed the intent of this ordinance is assist people who have the requirements to have elderly parents or in-laws living at home where they can take care of them. Having been in and out of nursing homes for the last 4 years on a regular basis, I see a flood of elderly parents coming down the road in the next 20 years. I don't think we can even imagine standing here today the impact that that's going to have. And I think if the intent of the ordinance is to provide that accommodation, particularly for those who are needy, we're not going to find those people perhaps in the larger lots in town, but more perhaps in the medium-sized lots in many cases. In any event, if we have two lot sizes for two residential districts, perhaps it's appropriate to consider two lot size minimums for the accessory dwelling unit. And this is said with due consideration to the issue, and I think the very high concern that the board had with respect to the preservation of property values. The board had a tremendous concern. I think many of our regulations and laws are passed not for the 99% of people who abide by them, but the fear of the 1% who won't. There is certainly concern to be had of people who would take advantage of this ordinance to convert single-family residential units into subsidized rental units, not subsidized rental units, but rental units, where there might not be a close association between the people who own the house and the people who are renting the house. Those are the conclusion of my comments. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? If not, I'll close the public hearing and move on to the item that's on the agenda. Item 114, should consider a public hearing comments on proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance regarding to accessory dwelling units and take any necessary action. Anybody from the council care to speak?
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Cogswell.
I move that we approve the ordinance changes as presented with the deletion of the requirement for owner occupancy.
Do I hear a second?
I would second that.
We also have here tonight our town planner and our town attorney, too, if people have questions of them.
Anybody from the council care to speak? Councilor Linnell.
I'd just like to hear a little more discussion, maybe from, I don't know, the town planner, on the 12,000, 15,000 issue. I'd just like to hear a little more about that. Or if you have any thoughts on that? No? Maybe you're the wrong person to pick, but.
Well, just to paraphrase what Tom Emery had talked about, there was a lot of discussion about what the minimum lot size was supposed to accomplish. It's only going to apply to existing dwellings. If someone wants to build a brand new house with an accessory dwelling unit, they're going to have to meet the minimum lot size for that zone, which in the RC zone would be 20,000 square feet, in the RA zone would be 80,000 square feet. So this minimum lot size only applies to people who have an existing home who may want to add an accessory dwelling unit to it. So if you look at people in that situation, they, first of all, you have to keep in mind that when you set those type of very specific standards, the door is shut immediately. You walk in, you find out that your lot is 4,999 square feet. The zoning ordinance says 15,000, and there's no appeal. That is not a standard that you can go and get waived in some other fashion. It's a flat standard. So. Some of the other things the board looked at is if you look at the other provisions in the draft in front of you, if someone owns an existing home, they're limited to converting no more than 25% of the home to the accessory dwelling unit. So 75% of the dwelling has to remain as part of the original single family home. So that's a limit on how much activity can go on in the house. Further, the accessory dwelling unit can be no smaller than 300 square feet, no larger than 600 square feet. So again, there's a limit on how big that unit is going to be. And finally, the house the original house can only be expanded by no more than 15%. So if someone comes in, they want to add an accessory dwelling unit, they want to add on to their home as part of the accessory dwelling unit, a portion of that unit has to be conversion of the existing home. They cannot just add the whole thing on to the rear. So then what the board did, and we're grateful to Tom, who's becoming our unpaid graphic expert, and what he did is he did some just some average lot sizes, put on some average building footprints for the typical home in Cape Elizabeth, a 26 by 30 home, and placed it on a lot with the average setbacks and showed it on a 10, a 12, a 15, a 20,000 square foot lot. And what you come to find out is that usually the difference is how much backyard they have. The frontage tends to be about the same. And that's why the board landed on the 12,000, because it seemed like as you got larger, because you could only expand the existing home so much, even if you had a larger home, it didn't seem like the impact would be all that great. But in the end, it is a judgment call.
Thank you.
Okay. I take that. Council Mab.
Just a couple questions for Councilor Cogsall. When you said you wanted to amend that, would that strike all of item 8, and also would it change? I did this kind of in a backwards order here. Would it strike all of number 8, or just part of that paragraph?
It would just be, and be owner occupied.
Just that part of it.
Right.
Then back on the first page, under D, would we strike out something about people who have close personal relationships? Would we have to strike that also?
This is meant to sort of give the original intent of why we're allowing this to happen. And no, we'd leave that in, because it's showing the basic reason why we're stretching our whole concept of single family homes to allow this opportunity.
And this came to the ordinance committee from the planning board?
The original impetus came from the Zoning Board of Appeals, and they were the ones who had to wrestle with it. And they had been asking, excuse me, for about 5 or 6 years that we clarify something. They had difficulty with trying to do what was termed the living space area. And so at times they would calculate that you had to not include hearths of fireplaces or closet space, and that got to be a little ridiculous. So by adding this, using the idea that you use the footprint of a house, which is clearly defined in the overall zoning ordinance and it's used throughout it, now you know exactly where you begin your calculations.
I see. So did the ordinance committee voted on this then? As a whole?
The ordinance committee worked on it for about 4 different meetings and brought it to you, and we referred it to the planning board. The planning board worked on it for 4 or 5 meetings, and in utter frustration sent it back to us. And during their last meeting, and I watched many of them, they kind of threw up their hands and said 12,000, 15,000. You know, they had one vote to carry the 12,000. The general feeling of the planning board, if I may speak for Mr. Emery, but having watched it and spoken with many of them, is that there was a very, very strong opinion that this should not be allowed at all, that it is detrimental to the whole concept of single-family homes, which is the whole basis of Cape Elizabeth and the whole economy of Cape Elizabeth. But they decided that since it was part of their responsibility to review these things, they did make some recommendations and send it back to us. And the major change, we just brought it back to the 15,000 square feet, which is where it had been in the original ordinance from 1987. Larry Clough, who was chairman of the Zoning Board at 2 different times, sat in with us in our original deliberations, and he contributed heavily to what he thought would be good criteria and how it would be able to, they would be able to deal with it much more clearly.
And do we get this tonight from the ordinance committee in a unanimous form then?
It came, yes.
Great.
Well, no.
Say no.
I will say no, because in the existing ordinance, you have to have 2,500 square feet for your house. And I believe it should stay at that level. But I was outvoted, so it's down to 1,500. So what we're really doing is increasing the opportunity for citizens to be able to apply for an accessory dwelling unit. And if you want a little more history, I was on the zoning board when this first thing was drafted. We did not have the expertise of a professional planner, really. It was something that wasn't done that commonly, but these things existed and people were applying and we had no ordinance, so we came up with a basic criteria. Since then, the overall ordinance has been improved greatly. And the origin of the 15,000 square feet, for all of you who are thinking we're just picking a figure out of the air, as Tom said, the old RC zone was 10,000 square feet. It was up to 20,000 square feet. We thought it would not be fair to eliminate the ones that were in between that range. And also at that time, you could use the sewer ordinance as far as lot size. And so the 15,000 feet, square feet, between being sort of a figure that was an average of various neighborhoods that had smaller lots, also tied into the connection to the public sewer. You had to have that square footage before you could apply, and you had to be on the public sewer. So that was where we came up with that original figure. We also talked with various tax assessors, and they say when they are looking at property in an area that is basically single family, and the town is single family, that in their estimation, in their evaluation, it does decrease the value of the house. From the realtor's point of view, they feel it is a selling point sometimes, but it really does not overall. It does have a negative impact in many instances.
Thank you.
All set? You all set? Anybody else? Councilor Dahlbeck.
Yeah, I would just like to add, I think there's been some misconceptions about this proposed ordinance at times. I've seen the words affordable housing. This is not an attempt for affordable housing. I think we've addressed affordable housing in other areas of our zoning ordinances. We're not talking about a unit that is going to be so big. We're dealing with quote-unquote two-family houses. 350 to 600 square foot is pretty cramped, and this envisions that if you have somebody in it, they would appreciate the elbow room to get out into the rest of the house on occasion. We've had a lot of discussion about in-laws. I just want to remind people that I think in this modern day, and probably a sad commentary, this is not just in-laws. Some of the situations that relate to this that I know of, and which exist in my neighborhood and your neighborhood, are children, single mothers, with a child coming back to the roost for something affordable. So I really feel very strongly that this is a very necessary step to take.
All set?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
I have a couple of problems with it. I have had since I got on the zoning ordinance committee. And I hate to put anything in black and white that's going to affect a fellow that owns a little less expensive home against a fellow that owns the big one with a big lot. This bothers me a little bit. I like to see everybody treated on the same even scale if I can. I know that you've got to put something in there that regulates size. I have no problem with the 1,500 square feet of for the accessory dwelling unit. I have no problem with the 300 square feet to a maximum of 600 square feet for the extra place to live. I think those are fine, but ever since we talked about it, and we've had 10, 15, 20, and all these figures given to us about lot size, again, I would like to see that thought about, and the possibility that our judgment of 15,000, which is a 100 by 150 foot lot, And I don't think, in my mind, that the fellow with 120 by 130-foot lot should say no, 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 and yes, 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 because the other fellow has 20 foot of land more. That bothers me.
You propose.
Thank you. Amendment? Anybody else? Hmm? Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have a couple of specific questions for the town planner. She could come on down. I apologize for not getting these to you sooner. In the proposed definition, accessory dwelling unit, a subordinate dwelling unit, accessory to and wholly contained within a main building and or attached garage, which a single family dwelling unit is the principal use. The last part of that, in which a single family dwelling unit is the principal use, is the word unit necessary there?
A lot of the wording in here may sound a little stilted. And the reason it sounds that way is we have been trying as much as possible to use the exact same terminology that is already defined in the zoning ordinance. And right now, dwelling unit is a term that's defined in the zoning ordinance. I'd be perfectly happy to say single family home. I've seen how creative people can be with interpreting definitions, and so I've been maybe a little overly cautious in continuing to use the same terminology. That's why it's written that way, to specifically refer to that dwelling unit definition in the zoning ordinance.
All right, thank you. And in provision number 3, where it's discussing that the unit shall occupy no more than 25% of the floor area, the very end of that interior connecting doorway between the single family dwelling, we don't say dwelling unit, in the accessory dwelling unit, shall be provided. Could we put a period after provided and dismiss with the last few words of that sentence? Do you have that?
I'm sorry, I'm not sure where you want to put the period.
It's the very
bottom of the page, first page.
First page, you want to omit the commingling of residents?
Yes.
That was something that was recommended by one of your fellow counselors, and certainly you could eliminate it if you want to.
Okay, does it, in your, as a planner who has worked on this, never mind, I won't do that to you.
It was left in there or inserted in there to get, once again, to emphasize the idea that it's not supposed to be a completely separate rental unit. It's supposed to be, hopefully, for family or extended family.
I just personally am not comfortable with that last phrase.
Why?
Because I think, who's going to go in and enforce the fact that they're commingling between the two units?
It doesn't say
that promotes the commingling of living space. That's not something you, if you want it as the intent, you put it in the intent statement. You don't put it in your criteria statements.
Councilor Dalbert.
Could I just respond to that? As indicated by Councilor Coggeshall, number one, I think it tries to reinforce what the intent of this is all about. Number two, it addresses the design of the unit. It does not address what people happen to be doing. I don't think it's the business of the town or the town council to get involved in what people do in their units.
That's why I don't think it should be in there.
Anything else?
I have another question for the planner. One concern that has been voiced either this evening or in a letter is how explicit is this language that there would be only one accessory dwelling unit per single family house?
I have seen that language before, and I know that we had looked at this and made sure that it was only allowing the creation of one, and that was always the intent, but I guess I may put the town attorney on the spot and have him also go over that first paragraph to make sure. I know that was clearly the intent.
I certainly understood that all along to be the intent, but I'm not sure it's real explicit.
Can I just try a response to that? I think there are two responses. We have talked about unit, not plural units. and we have talked in item number one for the addition of an, which is very singular, accessory dwelling unit, again, singular.
If I could, I'd like to add something to that. It also seems to me that with the restrictions on the square footage and so forth, that any second proposed unit would be awful small. So, so I don't think there's much danger of that happening.
If there is a concern, it certainly wouldn't be difficult to add a sentence to the first paragraph under D that says only one accessory dwelling unit shall be allowed per lot.
Mr. Hill, you're going to fire us all away, I think.
While you're sitting.
Actually, I can't claim credit for this because Mr. Goldman suggested it, but in the first sentence of D, the purpose of this provision shall be to permit the creation of a, we could add the word single, a single subordinate dwelling unit within an incidental to an existing family dwelling. That, I think the rest of the ordinance does speak in terms of in the singular as a dwelling unit, but it certainly wouldn't hurt to add the word single in the first sentence where I suggested.
Thank you.
Would that
Thank
be
you.
A better change than Maureen adding a completely separate sentence?
Whichever you prefer, I think that they both would make it clarify that it's just one accessory dwelling unit.
Mr. Chairman, I also thank you very much. That were good answers. I share a concern.
You still want the planner?
Who knows?
Who knows? I didn't want to run and bang and forth.
She's
going to sit down
He's
closer.
To sit closer. I share a concern that's been voiced by others here this evening with the 15,000 square foot lot minimum. And I'm curious, maybe I'd prefer to have the chairman of the planning board back up and pose a question to him, if I may, through the chair. People are exercising. If I heard you correctly, Mr. Emery, you were proposing a consideration for two different lot size minimums depending on the zoning district?
I was that is something that didn't come up as part of the planning board's discussions, but during concerns raised during the public hearing about minimum lot size, and particularly with the diagram that was placed before the council, it occurred to me that we have two zoning districts for residential which have two different lot sizes, that perhaps this ordinance could deal with that directly rather than assuming that there's one condition of lot size that meets all requirements for the town. I think the point that was made earlier that the minimum lot size for new lots is 20,000 square feet anyway, so there's no issue there at all. It's just a matter of the great areas that have already developed as to whether or not it's appropriate to have something as small as 12,000 square feet or smaller with an accessory dwelling unit. Ms. Cogshell, Council Cogshell, was correct. There was a lot of discussion among the board with respect to the purpose of the ordinance and whether the board should be endorsing the ordinance. But after some debate, and keeping in mind that we also have people of very different interests on the board, we have real estate people, we have architects, we have attorneys, and so forth, it was agreed that the board would send forth ordinance language to the committee and to the council that we would endorse, that we would not say, well, this is the best we can do, and if you're going to pass it, go ahead and pass it. It was very much our intent that what was forwarded to the council would be forwarded with some support.
And your proposal, the planning board's proposal, was a 12,000 square
correct.
Foot lot, is my recollection.
All set?
Thank you, Tom.
Thank you. All done?
I'm all
done.
More questions to those folks. Now I can talk.
Yes, you may talk.
Thank you. Yeah, I still feel that the 15,000 square foot requirement is excessive, knowing the character of the town and knowing and what I can envision is a fair number of lots we would automatically be cutting out, and I think those might be somewhere it could work quite well without a rash of negative impacts. I think a lot of the negative impacts I'm hearing people express their fears about can happen if you have a large family moving into those properties. A lot of it we don't have any control over right now, and I think we're going a bit overboard with some of that. But I do think this work in general is a step in the right direction.
Thank you. Yes, Councilor Nell.
I wanted to say that for a man of my youth, I've already been through this, and I can tell you that the first thing you run into if you have relatives that have that need to live with you is dealing with a space, and it's a problem. And so I've got to say that I think that if an in-law is lucky enough to have a family that will take them in, I think it's that's wonderful, and that the government should really stay out of that, stay out of people's homes. And it seems to me that so many more people would potentially be eliminated by restricting the lot size than would even be in the situation to be able to use it. I'd like to see us give people a break on this, because again, it's so restrictive. There's very little or no opportunity to change it if your lot size is 100 feet smaller. And I'm just looking at the diagram of the relative 10,000 square foot lot and the 12,000, 15,000, whatnot, and I don't see that 12,000 is going to have that much of an adverse effect more compared to the 15,000. So I guess what I'd like to do is suggest or in advance an amendment to the current motion to change the 15,000 square foot lot size to 12,000 foot and insert the word single in paragraph D in front of subordinate as the town attorney suggested.
Second. You make an edit of motion?
Yes, sir.
And we have a second.
You asking for a second or did you just second?
We did get a second.
Okay, good.
Okay. So what I would like to do is have a couple of words before we vote on the amendment and vote on the issue. I am concerned in D, one or two people. I don't think you should specify how many can live there. I don't think 60 or six or something like that, but I don't think you would say one, two, maybe three would want to be there. A daughter and two children or something to that effect, and I think that should be closed out, and I think I spoke about that earlier. And I think the problem with what people get concerned about, if you don't do anything with the outside of the building other than put a door in, I don't think you're adversely affecting the neighborhood. I think that is used too often for anybody that parks another car in their dooryard because of somebody else that's living there. Is that adversely affecting your neighborhood? And I don't think you should shut the door on this, because I've been down that road about elderly people, parents, and what have you, and I think if it's all possible anyways that you can make a comfortable place for any of your relatives, and instead of going to a nursing home, I think that ought to be allowed to do it. Now, whether that would, I don't think it would adversely affect the town of Cape Elizabeth or the neighborhood. So I'll move on from there. And did you want to say a couple of words?
Is that okay?
Yes.
I wanted to back up something that Councilor Dahlbeck had said earlier with regard to in-law apartments and children. I think that an awful lot of people my age are starting to move back in with their parents, and I'm not sure if that's something either the parents or the children are really crazy about, but unfortunately, it's a necessity at this point.
Giving your parents a message?
Yeah. No, not me. no, my parents had children in the house for 40 consecutive years. I don't think they want any back. But I do, as many of you know, sit on the Human Resources Committee in Augusta as part of my work as your state representative, and we've been visiting elderly housing all over the state. And very much the trend today in housing is that we try to keep people in their home as long as possible. Institutionalizing people has proven to be not the best solution to those kind of problems. And if it's not possible to keep the people in their own home, the second best choice, so the experts tell us, is to get them in with a family member. And this accessory dwelling unit proposal certainly supports that kind of idea. And therefore, I'm going to be voting in support of this tonight. And I think that it's important for us to realize that Cape Elizabeth is a community of a lot of different kind of people, and we need to allow them to live here and to be comfortable with their homes. And it's not the job of government to be telling families that they can't take care of their own. Thank you.
Yes, Councilor Coggeshall.
I just want to make one comment about all of a sudden bringing up this 12,000 square foot lot. Because of the comments that have previously been made about a 15,000 square foot lot supposedly being arbitrary and not based on fact or study, I think this 12,000 square foot lot is that. We don't really have a breakdown of how many would even fall into that category. I just don't think it's the correct way to write an ordinance or set a criteria.
Councilor McLaughlin.
I would like to respectfully disagree with that. That's the recommendation we had from the planning board. And it has been discussed before, and I have brought it up before. It's not all of a sudden bringing it up tonight.
It was a recommendation of the planning board. I watched their whole discussion. And they were either not going to send it to us, and then they decided they should make a comment, so they changed the square footage. And even then, it was that last meeting of all their series of meetings.
Phyllis Kroger.
All set now? Anybody else? Okay, you want to? The motion is that we are going to vote on the amendment, which was which was placed on the agenda on the table by Councilor Nell. Does everybody understand the motion?
15 to 12.
15 to 12.
And the single.
And singles.
Adding a single subordinate dwelling unit under D, right?
Everybody understand it? All those in favor of the motion, please indicate it by raising your right hand. Those opposed? Motion is carried on a 5-2 vote. You ready to vote on the motion? Of adoption?
As amended.
All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? 6-1. Okay, thank you for coming. Item 113, which is a table item of 1995. Anybody care to move to bring it from the table?
So moved.
We'll hear a second.
Second.
Been moved and seconded, and we bring item 113 from the table. Please raise your hand. Please raise your hand.
Excuse me, some of us weren't paying enough attention. Mr. Chairman, could you repeat what we're raising our hand about?
You're raising your hand to bring item 13 from the table. 113.
We're removing it from the table, sir.
Fine.
Okay.
All set?
That's what's set.
That's a vote. Item 113, to consider a proposed settlement with Plummer versus Town of Cape Elizabeth and take any necessary action. Yeah. The manager, I believe, has a couple of words.
Yes, this item comes to the town council and to the public forum this evening After, I would guess, about 4 or 5 executive sessions with the town council reviewing this item over the last year, like other items that this council sometimes deals with, it does come from litigation, and it has been a case that's in place for some time. I'm pleased that there does appear to be an agreement, and Mike Hill, who is one of the town attorneys, is here this evening to provide an overview of the proposed agreement and also a proposed emergency ordinance that would effectuate the agreement.
Sir, are you ready?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The council is well aware of the history of this litigation and the status of the case, but I'd like to give a brief overview for the benefit of the audience. This litigation started in the fall of 1988 after the town council refused to rezone 4 lots owned by the F.S. Plumber Company and Fred S. Plumber individually in the Eastfield subdivision in the town. After the litigation commenced, one of the lots, which was partially in the RP, or Resource Protection District, and partially in the residential district, was allowed to be built upon under existing ordinances. So we're left with 3 lots, lots 27, 31, and 32, which are the subject matter of this litigation. The Plumbers brought a 6 or 7 count complaint alleging numerous things of wrongdoing against the town. That case went to the Maine Supreme Judicial Court, and the town's position, the actions of the town council, and the various administrative or town administrative people were upheld. The Supreme Court sent the sole remaining count on the Plumbers' takings claim back to the Superior Court for a trial on the facts. The Plumbers' claim is basically that the town of Cape Elizabeth denied them all viable economic use of lots 27, 31, and 32, and that the town should compensate the Plumbers for that alleged loss. While we were preparing for the trial, we hired, the town hired a couple of experts, wetlands experts, soil scientists, to delineate the wetlands on these 3 lots. Our experts, first the Plumbers were arguing that all 3 lots should be zoned residential A and that buildings should be permitted on each lot. Our experts disagreed but did find some areas on lots 27 and 32, which were non-wetland, upland areas. I put in your packet the map by one of our experts, Woodlot Alternatives, which delineates the wetlands on lots 27, 31, and 32. The soils on lot 27 actually give a sufficient area for a building envelope. There's no area on lot 31 which would support a building, and there's a small area of upland on lot 32. If the resource protection map in 1988 were to have been drawn as our experts have indicated on that map, then the Plumbers quite possibly could have gotten a building permit on lot 27 and 32. There was a provision in the 1988 ordinance which allowed a lot owner that had a lot that was divided between two zones to encroach 30 feet into the more restrictive zone. This would have allowed for a modest building envelope on lot 32, but would have required some filling of the wetland area on lot 32. We've explored settlement discussions with the Plumbers along those lines of a building permit for lot 27 and 32. The stumbling block has been that neither 27 or 32 would support a subsurface wastewater disposal system and therefore would have to be hooked up to the sewer, public sewer. The sewer was put in with substantial grant money from the federal government, and that grant money had conditions on it that no new construction could hook up to the sewer if that new construction were in whole or in part in a wetland area. And as I stated before, in Lot 32, the portion of the building would have to be in a wetland area. At this point, I would recommend that the town council authorize the town manager to enter into a settlement agreement with the plumbers, conditioned upon obtaining a waiver of the special grant condition which would otherwise prohibit construction on Lot 32. The settlement would require or necessitate the town council to adopt an emergency ordinance to change the zone, the RP map, if you would, to have a portion of 27 and a portion of Lot 32 be included in the RA zone, as shown on the map that is in your packet. I would point out that the it's my understanding that the plumbers have obtained from the Army Corps of Engineers a permit for construction on Lot 32. And so if the settlement agreement were approved by you, the only outstanding condition would be the Environmental Protection Agency's waiver of that special grant condition. That waiver has been applied for. I spoke with the head of the I can't remember exactly what his title is, but Wetlands Protection Section, I think, of the EPA down in Boston today. He thought he would have a decision by the end of this month, and indications were that that waiver would be granted, but of course there's no guarantee that it would be. So I think that the proposed settlement agreement, which the basics are that the emergency ordinance would be passed, changing the zoning map, which would allow building permits for lots 27 and 32, that lots 31 and 32 be combined under the large lot commitment section in our ordinance, which would prevent any further development on Lot 31. There would be no building allowed, no filling of wetlands on that area. The other aspect of the settlement agreement would be that a sum of money, which I believe is $18,000, which was donated to the town for construction of drainage easements in the Eastfield subdivision, would be returned to the plumbers. I think that this proposed settlement serves two purposes. It minimizes the impact on the wetland area in this section of town. There would be a very modest amount of filling on Lot 32 to allow for this construction. It would have been allowed under our ordinances in existence in 1988 when this whole matter began, and as I said, has been approved by the Army Corps of Engineers. It would also eliminate the risk of an adverse judgment against the town, although we're confident that we would prevail in litigation. You never know how a matter is going to turn out. I think that that risk, although it may be small, could be totally avoided by this settlement with a minimum impact, minimum negative impact on the wetland area. If anyone has any questions, I'd be happy to.
Anyone have? Councilor Coggeshall.
I want to know specifically what the motion should be, and is there a map that indicates that we're approving tonight exactly what we're approving? I'm not sure this one by Woodlots Associates is what we really need. I don't think it's clear enough, the way it's laid out.
The legend on the Woodlot Alternatives map indicates where the Resource Protection District, in the opinion of our expert, should be. And it's the symbol for a wetland, and it shows portions of Lot 27, almost all of 31, and the majority of Lot 32 as resource protection. So I think that if the town council were to adopt the emergency ordinance, which is before you, which references this map, that it would be clear that the Resource Protection District covers only that portion of Lot 27 as designated on this map, almost all of Lot 31 and the majority of Lot 32.
Okay. No?
I still don't quite understand that this is going to be strictly for these areas, and this is going to allow what to be done? Construction only on the filled areas?
It would allow construction that was in under the ordinances which were in effect in 1988,
okay.
Which would mean a building envelope on Lot 27 in the area that's designated as fill, which is partially fill, and actually some of that is upland area, but it's so shallow to bedrock that a subsurface wastewater disposal system could not be placed there, and it have to be hooked up to sewer. With respect to Lot 32, under the 1988 ordinances, the lot owner would be able to encroach 30 feet into what's designated RP on this map. And so there would be some filling, a small portion of filling on the wetland area on Lot 32. And but it would all be in accordance with the ordinances which were in effect when this matter first came before the
And the
town
construction
council.
Would only be in Lot 32, not 31.
That's
that,
correct.
That area that is now designated Lot 32, since it's becoming one lot.
That's right. It'll become one lot for construction purposes, sewer, and tax assessment. So even though the registry of it will be recorded in the registry of deeds that these two lots are forever joined, there would be no construction ever allowed on Lot 31. That's correct. The motion, I believe, if you wanted to go forward with this settlement proposal, would be to authorize the town manager to enter into the proposed settlement agreement, which is also in your package, with the condition that precondition that the town, that the Environmental Protection Agency waive the special grant condition 18 of the sewer grant.
Okay. You got that? Councilor Dalbert.
I guess what I was going to try to do is get this thing moving by making a motion. And my motion would be, correct me as I go, Michael, thank you, to approve the settlement agreement and the proposed emergency ordinance that were attached to Mr. Hill's letter dated February 24th, 1995, including the maps attached thereto, and that these, I guess we want to add on that something about the conditioned upon getting the approvals from the federal authorities.
EPA.
Right. You could just say on the precondition that the Environmental Protection Agency grant a waiver of Special Condition 18.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Anybody else got a comment? No other comment? Thank you, Michael. I think you've done a tremendous job in spelling it out for everybody to understand. So I'll call for the motion. All in favor? Please indicate by raising your hand. Those opposed? It's a vote. 7-0.
Just one clarifying question. I assume, for purposes of the clerk's record, that the motion did include the authorization to expend $18,000 from undesignated surplus.
That was covered in that settlement agreement write-up.
I think it was unclear the source of the funds. And
everybody agree?
Undesignated funds.
Undesignated surplus.
Or whatever.
Item 115, to consider a report from the Appointments Committee regarding a proposed charge to the Pedals and Protesting Plan Committee and take any necessary action. I'd like that comment. Mr. Manager.
Yes, Councilor McLaughlin, as chairman of the Appointments Committee, asked me to do an introduction to this. This has been developed over several meetings of the town council as a result of a lot of comments that came at public hearing that the town needed to do a little bit more planning in terms of what it ought to be doing with bikeways, sidewalks, and the green belt. Specifically, as this was drafted, it would establish a steering committee called the P-Square Steering Committee, or Pedals and Pedestrians Steering Committee, that would assess through an extensive public participation process the need for bike lanes, sidewalks, and green belt trails in the town. It'd be an evaluation of bicyclist and pedestrian facility needs that would hopefully be used in the future to allocate infrastructure expenditures consistent with standards that would be developed through this process so that we didn't have grant applications going that weren't consistent. One, with a plan that had been developed, and two, that weren't specifically expressly authorized by the town council just prior to their application. Also, there's a draft committee charge that indicates that there'd be a written status report to the council by the end of this calendar year. There'd be a final draft of a plan by the end of May of 1996. Again, an emphasis on extensive public interaction. The steering committee itself would consist of 11 members. Two of them would be members of the town council, a member of the planning board, a member of the conservation commission, and 7 members of the general public. This committee would not specifically design any facilities. It is a planning process, and it would outline recommendations to the town council and where these types of facilities ought to occur. As a result of the previous, or the last discussion of the town council, this draft does have an amendment to it that's printed in the draft, number 3 on the reverse side, indicating that any criteria that's developed should be consistent with the 1993 comprehensive plan. That was an issue that the town council raised at your last meeting.
Thank you. Councilor McLaughlin, you have anything to add to that? No?
Wishful thinking. I know we've had a lot of citizens express interest in serving on this committee if, in fact, it does become formed by the council this evening or in the future. And we will be advertised. I'm going to assume that this is going to be a positive vote, so take my remarks in that light, please. We will be advertising in the Cape Courier because of the deadlines and such. If this proceeds, the Appointments Committee will not be able to bring a recommendation of potential members for this planning process committee back to the council until the May meeting. The ad, I believe, would be in the first April edition of the Courier. This will not be under the April Fool's column, however. And because of time frame for people to get their responses in and for the Appointments Committee to go through interviews, and we already know of more than a dozen people have indicated they're interested. Those people will need to go through the application process and the interview with the Appointments Committee. One thing that has changed, and this was last discussed in full council meeting, was originally The proposal was to have a 9-member committee. We have increased that to 11 members so that there would be 2 more members from the public on the committee. We are expecting the committee to have co-chairmen, whom would be appointed by the town council chairman. And I think the town manager did a very slick job in getting a proposal to PAX and getting approval of it for the funding of this process. That seemed to have gone very smoothly. I was in a meeting, I guess, a couple of weeks ago with Councillor Chappell, also attended with a representative from PAX to go over some of the criteria that they were looking for. And again, they were emphasizing that it is, as the manager did, is a planning committee. There will be no specific designs for any particular roadway or any particular property in town come out of this committee. I'm hoping people applying to serve on the committee will understand that it is a planning process. There are going to be a lot of meetings, and there's going to be very extensive public participation. We want this to be a very fair process, and that's what we're all envisioning. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Anybody else? Do we hear a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move that the council approve the creation of the Pedals and Pedestrians Process Planning Committee.
I second it.
Been moved and seconded. Anybody else got a comment? Would you like to add the fees to it, on the budget to it, your motion?
Do we need to do that?
You don't need to do it?
It's in the document.
It's in the document, but
you're going to take that up as
we have another item.
Okay.
Yeah, I just had one comment. I really want to express appreciation to Maureen O'Meara, the town planner who worked very closely with the chairman of the appointments committee in drafting this whole discussion draft. It was a difficult animal to put together, and she did a fine job doing it at the direction of the council and the appointments committee.
Councilor Marvin, do you have a comment?
I just wanted to understand the budget for this. It says that it's $14,000, but I also have here a motion to consider accepting a PAX grant. Do those two go together? Or?
Yes, there's a second item that's a total of the item that will follow this would essentially give this project planning process a budget of a total of $14,000. $11,200 of that would come from PAX, from planning monies that were allocated to them in a previous year that they haven't used and were willing to devote to this project. And $2,800 would be the town share that is recommended in that item. It's coming from town council contingency.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Yes, Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you. I just want to pass on a couple of concerns or comments that had been raised as this is being developed, that it is a very optimistic time frame to accomplish what is proposed here in 1 year. When that was pointed out to me, I concurred that it was very optimistic, but I also stated that I felt it was quite important to this council to have the work done within 1 year. That brings up an opportunity for people who may not want to serve on the committee itself, but may want to be on what I'm expecting will be one of the subcommittees that will be volunteering to do some of the inventory work and such, and there will be some of that out there that needs to be done. We're going to need a lot of people participating in this, and I hope that folks will feel comfortable coming forth to do some of that field work for us without even having to serve on the committee. Thank you.
Yes, Councilor Coggeshall.
Having Councilor McLaughlin mention the word inventory, I recall that one of the assignments that were given was given to the Conservation Commission was to do an inventory of the paper streets and some of those that connected with the Greenbelt. Would this be part of that inventory process for the Greenbelt section of this?
It will be something that will be looked at. I've had it was originally in the Conservation Commission. It was taken back out of the Conservation Commission, and it is going to be done as a separate study. I've had discussions with John Boubier, at Greater Portland Council of Governments, and they're setting up a process that we would be first on the list of helping communities in going through the inventory of paper streets. But once that initial inventory is done and the deeds and the different plats are looked at, The key point of that is someone is going to need to do an assessment of which of these ought to be retained and which shall not be retained. And, you know, my intent was to work with anyone and everyone on that, because you have issues not only of conservation and green belt, but you also have potential water lines, fire access roads, sidewalks, you know, you name it, on potential uses of these rights of way. So I anticipate that that will be, you know, if that was dumped on this committee, that in and of itself is a major, major project. But this committee will be made aware of that. And my sense is by the time this really gets rolling, some of the initial work will be done that shows some of those resources that are out there for potential use.
Good.
All set? Ready for the vote? All those in favor of the motion, please indicate by raising your hand. Thank you. 7-0. Item 116, to consider accepting a PAX grant for the pedals and pedestrian study and take any necessary action. Now you can get on to your $14,000. Do you want to reiterate? No. Everybody understand it? Do I hear a motion to accept it?
I move we accept it, Mr. Chairman.
Been moved and seconded. Anybody got a comment? No? All in favor, raise your hand. As the vote, 7-0. Moving right along. Item 117.